Sarah Mousley from here, and talk about existence of boundary maps for some hyperbolic spaces.
Okay. Well, thank you for allowing me to speak in this seminar. So today I'm going to talk to you about my work about the existence and non-existence of boundary maps between some metric spaces that admit structures called hierarchically hyperbolic space structures. But I've designed this talk to be pretty self-contained, so if you're unfamiliar with HHS structures, it's really okay. Believe me, you'll be able to follow the talk. Okay, so first though, I want to tell you what a boundary map is. So what's the setting? We start with two metric spaces, H and G. And I'll denote, well, I'll draw a little picture and make it bigger. One blob for H, one blob for G. Okay, and then I'm going to have some map between them. Okay, and we'll say that this map phi extends to a boundary map. By the way, I'm thinking of H and G as each equipped with some notion of boundary, which is like implicit in the problem when you talk about a boundary map. So phi extends to a boundary map if there exists a map from G union its boundary to H union its boundary. Because it's going to be an extension map, so. Right. There exists a map here that extends phi that's continuous at all points p in the boundary of H. So in practice, what does this actually mean? You take a point in the boundary of H, and you consider two sequences that converge to P. So I'll call them H1, so I have HN, and then some other sequence, HN bar. Okay, and then you apply phi, and you see what these sequences do over in G, the image of the sequences. And if it turns out that they each converge to a point in the boundary and converge to the same point, then you can build one of these extension maps by sending P to Q, and that extension will be continuous at P. So that's what I mean when I'm talking about a boundary map. So first I want to give you an example of when you have one of these boundary maps. So take H to be some Gromov hyperbolic space. What does this mean? It means that there exists a delta greater than or equal to zero, such that for all geodesic triangles, we have the following condition satisfied. So some triangle XYZ, I want that each side is contained in the union of the delta neighborhoods of the other two sides. So I think what I said is this. Z, Y. Okay, so in a picture, this is my triangle. I'm saying that if I take the delta neighborhood of this side and then the delta neighborhood of this side, it completely contains this third side right here. So if you have such a delta, this is called a Gromov hyperbolic space. So I'm going to actually take two of these, also let G be Gromov hyperbolic as well. And I'll just shorten that throughout the talk to just say hyperbolic instead of Gromov hyperbolic, okay? So now suppose that you have some map between these Gromov hyperbolic spaces. And suppose this map is a quasi-isometric embedding. What this means is that if you take two points in H and measure the distance there, and then you send them over to G and measure the distance over there, these numbers should basically be the same. They're just going to differ by some additive and multiplicative amount. So Okay, if you have one of these maps, call it phi, then it turns out that phi will extend to a boundary map. Okay, so here, what's the notion of boundary that we have? Well, anytime you have a Gromov hyperbolic space, there's something called the Gromov boundary that you can build for the space. So I'll denote the Gromov boundary of H like this. Okay, so how you can think of points in this Gromov boundary? A typical point is just a sequence in H. And it's a sequence with the following property. So imagine taking a point in H and standing at that point. And then the terms in the sequence should be getting farther and farther away from you. But not only should they be getting farther and farther away from you, from where you're standing, it should look like they're getting closer and closer to one another as n goes to infinity. Okay, so the Gromov boundary is just all sequences of this type. And actually, they're equivalence classes, but maybe that's kind of a technical point I don't want to get into. Okay, so there's an example of existence of a boundary map. So now what I want to do is tell you about the two spaces that will play the role of H and G throughout the rest of the talk. So the first space I want to tell you about is a right-angled Artin group. So how do you obtain one of these? You start with some finite graph gamma. And then you have labels for the vertices of gamma, S1 through SK. All right. And then the right-angled Artin group associated to gamma, which I'll denote like this, is the group with the following presentation. So the vertices of the graph are going to be the generators. And then what are the relations? They're all commuting relations, and they're Si, Sj equals Sj, Si, if and only if Si, Sj is an edge in the graph. So there's a description of the right-angled Artin group for you, given by its presentation. So that's the first space I'll care about. The second space is mapping class group. So you start with some surface, I'll denote by S. This is going to be a compact, orientable surface that doesn't have any boundary. Okay, and then we'll define the mapping class group of S to be the set of all orientation-preserving homeomorphisms of the surface. And we'll consider these up to the equivalence of isotopy. So that's the mapping class group. Okay, so you can think of both of these spaces, though I've described them as groups, you can think of them as metric spaces by fixing a finite generating set for each and then giving the groups the corresponding word metrics. So they fit the flavor of the spaces H and G that I was talking about at the beginning. So now I need to tell you about what the maps between these two spaces will be. Okay, so there's these constructions by Clay, Leininger, and Magenhaus that I'm going to tell you about now. Okay, so what these authors do is they construct quasi-isometric embeddings of right-angled Artin groups, which I'll shorten to RAGs, to mapping class groups. Okay, so these constructions give you right-angled Artin subgroups of mapping class groups, but the embeddings are also really nice because they're quasi-isometric, so they preserve some of the geometry going on with the right-angled Artin group. Okay, so those are the embeddings that we'll work with. So now I can pose the question. So the question is the following, which I hope this question will feel natural given what was going on for the Gromov hyperbolic spaces. So the question is, does every Clay, Leininger, Magenhaus embedding of a rag into a mapping class group extend to a boundary map? Okay, so sort of natural. These are QI embeddings. Gromov hyperbolic spaces, QI embedding yields extension. Is the same true in this setting? So this question was posed by Durham, Hagen, and Sisto. Okay, and it was answered by myself. Well, not by myself, I guess Chris kind of helped. Okay, so the answer is no. And to prove this, I give an explicit example where the extension map doesn't extend, or the inclusion map doesn't extend. Yeah, example of failure. Okay, so by the end of this talk, I'll have given you this example, but I'm not going to do that just yet. I want to tell you about another theorem along these lines that I've proved. Okay, so the other theorem speaks to existence. So this theorem says, you know, sometimes they don't extend. This next theorem is going to give you a condition under which the boundary, these boundary maps do exist. Okay, so the theorem is let A gamma be a free group. And I'll denote its vertices the same as before, S1 through SK. Let A gamma, let this be Clay-Leininger Magenhaus embedding. So if the supports of phi si pairwise fill the surface, okay, then this will imply that the embedding map, let's give it a name, phi extends to a boundary map. Okay, so that's the other theorem I've proved. I want to give you a quick example illustrating what this theorem is saying. And this will also give me an opportunity to show you what a Clay-Leininger-Magenhaus embedding actually is. Okay, so here's an example. Gamma is just going to be a two-vertex graph with no edges so that I get a free group of rank 2. Okay, and then my surface is going to be this genus 4 surface. Okay, now let's see, take this surface here. Let's see, yeah, let this be x1, and then let the rest here, let this be x2. Okay, now I can build a map from the right angle Artin group to the mapping class group of this surface as follows. I'm going to send the generator si to the mapping class group element that I'll denote fi. What's fi? This is some mapping class group element that is a pseudo Anosov on the subsurface xi. So if you haven't seen a pseudo Anosov before, you can just think of this as some mapping class group element that's supported on xi. So it's the identity outside of xi. Then inside xi, it's mixing up the surface. Okay, so some infinite order element doing crazy things on xi. So the result of Clay-Leininger and Magenhaus says that this map will be a QI embedding, provided that you pass to sufficiently high powers of the FI. But maybe I'll sweep that detail under the rug. Okay. So this is a QI embedding, and then what my theorem tells you is that because the union of X1 and X2 is equal to the entire surface, these two fill, this implies that phi extends to a boundary map. Okay, so there's a 2-for-1. You get to see my theorem, and you get to see what a Clay-Leininger-Magenhaus embedding looks like. Okay. Right, yeah, the boundary is the HHS boundary, which, like, thank you for the segue, because I'm about to tell you sort of a flaw in what I've been saying so far, which is I haven't really clarified what I mean here by a boundary map. Like, what are the boundaries at play? And so the only boundary we've talked about is the Gromov boundary so far, right? And this space isn't Gromov hyperbolic. I have copies of Z2 floating all over the place. And unless I'm working with free group, this guy's also not Gromov hyperbolic. So I need a different notion of boundary. It's called the hierarchically hyperbolic space boundary. I'll describe that construction now. And then after I describe for you what this boundary actually is, then I'll say a few words about why my theorem is true. So what we're going to do now is build a boundary for the mapping class group. Okay, so to do this, I'm going to start with a subsurface Y of my big surface, and I'm going to construct something called the curve graph of Y. So we'll denote this by CY. It's a graph, as you might have guessed from the name. And the vertices, these are simple closed curves. But they're not just on the surface. They're in Y, and they're essential in Y. What this means is that the curve can be homotoped to be completely contained inside Y and can't be homotoped to a point. So yeah, we consider these all up to homotopy. They're equivalence classes of curves. And then how do you decide if two curves should be adjacent? We have alpha, beta is going to be an edge in this curve graph, if and only if alpha and beta can be realized disjointly. Okay, so let's draw a picture really quick for example. Okay, so actually, maybe I don't want the color, because then you won't be able to see the curves if I try to color it. So forget the color. This surface here is just going to be Y, okay, the subsurface to the left. Now consider these curves. Okay, so since alpha, gamma, and beta are all contained inside Y, I have a vertex for each one of those. But eta is not contained inside Y, so I don't have a vertex corresponding to it. And now I have to decide how to make things adjacent. Well, alpha and gamma are disjoint, so there's an edge between them, but beta intersects both alpha and gamma. So those are all the edges between these three vertices. And this is just a small piece of the curve graph. Okay, so in general, well, this curve graph is pretty complicated. It's like locally infinite and infinite diameter. It's pretty complicated. But there's this theorem of Maser and Minsky that tells us a little bit of information about the curve graph of Y that we're going to take advantage of to build our boundary. So this theorem says that these curve graphs, they're Gromov hyperbolic. Okay, so what I'm going to do to build this boundary is, since each one of these is Gromov hyperbolic, it has a Gromov boundary, so I'm going to take look at all subsurfaces and all of their Gromov boundaries. So I have infinitely many Gromov boundaries, and I'm going to, from those infinitely many pieces, construct one boundary for the mapping class group. And I'll leave the question up. Okay, so here's the definition. And this definition is due to Durham, Hagen, and Sisto. Okay, so they define the boundary for the mapping class group to be all points of the following form. So it's some sum, and I sum over all subsurfaces of the entire surface. And what am I summing? Okay, I have to explain this notation. So Cy here is some non-negative coefficient. And what lambda y is it some point in the Gromov boundary of the curve graph of y. So what a point in this boundary looks like is a formal linear combination of points in the various boundaries of various curve graphs. Okay. There's a few extra conditions that I need to tag on here. One is that the sum of all of the coefficients has to be equal to 1. The reason for this condition, I think, will make a little bit more sense when we talk about the topology of this boundary. The fourth condition says that if you have the coefficients on two terms being being positive, non-zero, this implies that y and y prime are equal or disjoint. Okay. So if you're familiar with Mazur and Minsky's bounded geodesic image theorem, that theorem is sort of responsible for this condition being there. But if you don't know it, that's fine. Also, if you're familiar with Mazur and Minsky's distance formula for the mapping class group, this definition for the boundary of the mapping class groups should feel somewhat natural to you. Okay. So that's just the set-wise what the boundary is. So I need to tell you a little bit about the topology of this space. Okay, so to give a full definition of the topology would be pretty involved, so I'm not going to do that. But instead, I'm going to give you a few examples of where certain sequences converge to so that you can get the flavor of this topology. So here's the example I'll give you. So here's my surface, S. So take y to be this subsurface here, take z to be this one, and then define f to be some mapping class group element that's pseudo-Anosov on y, and then take g to be some element that's pseudo-Anosov on z. And then what I want to tell you is what the limit as n goes to infinity of fn g to the n is. Does that converge to a point in our boundary? If so, where does it go? So to figure out where it goes, what you do is you look at each curve graph, and then you see how your sequence moves curves through that curve graph. And you have to do this for each subsurface, okay? So since there seems to be some interesting dynamics going on in Y, I'll start with Y, but I'll look at all of them. Okay, so look at the curve graph of y, represented by this blob. And now fix some curve in y. Any curve will do. And I'm going to look at fn g to the n of alpha and see where that goes. So I can do some simplification here. Since g is supported on z, then g to the n does nothing. So this is just fn alpha, right? OK, so I'm looking at this sequence alpha, f alpha, f squared alpha. And I want to know where it's going. Based on how I've drawn my picture, you can probably guess that it converges to a point in the boundary. But this is actually a result of Mazur and Minsky. It takes some work. But it turns out that this sequence does converge to a point. I'll call it lambda y. And this is living inside the Gromov boundary of the curve graph of y. So because I have this convergence here, appearing in this limit is going to be lambda y. And I don't yet know what that coefficient is, but we'll come back. OK, so now other places where it seems like interesting stuff is happening would be in z. So we can draw a similar picture for z and see how the sequence moves curves through z. So the picture is pretty much the same. Now I take a curve beta in z, and I look at fn g, the n of beta. Again, f is supported on y, so this is just gn beta. So that's the sequence I'm looking at. And this also, again, by the work of Mazur and Minsky, converges to a point in the boundary. I'll call it lambda z. Okay, so same thing, we have lambda z appearing in the limit. And then what you have to do is you have to show, show given any subsurface y that's not, any subsurface w that's not equal to y and is not equal to z, you need to show that the diameter of the following set in the curve graph of W is bounded. So you take some curve gamma in W, and then you look at how fn g to the n moves away from gamma. And you want to see that this diameter is finite. Turns out that that will be true. I guess really, though, here, when I'm taking f and g to be pseudo-Nosov and y and z, I'm taking them so that they don't twist around the boundary curves of their support. So you know, I might have some issues with annuli, but I'm going to ignore those by assuming they don't twist. OK, so there's no term corresponding to a w then in my sum. And so now I just have to tell you what the coefficients are. What the coefficients are meant to reflect is basically relatively how fast the sequences are moving through the two curve complexes. So I'm making these numbers up, but just suppose that this guy moved at a rate of 4 times as fast, this sequence, as this one. Okay, so it moves 4 times as fast. The coefficients are going to reflect that. So they move at a rate of 1 to 4, and then I divide by the sum of those two numbers, 5, to projectivize. That's what the coefficients are. Or did I get those? Yeah, that's right. OK, didn't get them backwards. OK, I want to show you just one other example to illustrate some of the nuances to figuring out what these limits are. So this sequence looks pretty similar, but now I'm replacing the n with an n squared. And I want to know where that goes. So you play the same game. You see how does this sequence move curves through the various curve complexes. And you'll figure out that you have to use lambda y and lambda z as before. But now these coefficients are going to change. So now what happens basically is that the rate at which this sequence moves curves through z is so much faster than the rate at which this sequence moves curves through y. And so that it dominates. So what ends up happening is this one's a 1 and this one's a 0. Okay. So what I'm really saying is that the following limit is equal to 0. this is equal to 0. So that's the reason for the coefficients. Okay, so basically my point is that doing these problems isn't just as simple as seeing which curve graphs you go to infinity in. You have to see how fast, and that's kind of where some of the complication lies. Okay, so that's the topology of the boundary, and that's all I'll say about that. Okay, so what I've described to you so far is something called the hierarchically hyperbolic space structure for the mapping class group. This type of structure can be put on other metric spaces also, the right angle Artin groups being another example of where you can use these structures. So what an HHS structure roughly is you have your metric space, and then you have a family of Gromov hyperbolic spaces associated to your space. Okay, and then you take this family of Gromov hyperbolic spaces, and you take their boundaries, and you build a boundary for your original space. So you can play the same game for right angle Artin groups, but I don't want to because it's hard. So,
can I ask you before you? This subsurface, is it supposed to be convex or any subsurface?
So I'm thinking of these as like isotopy classes of surfaces, subsurfaces.
So can I take the whole surface in, like remove the ball from it?
No.
Would that be a
no.
Here?
No.
Why no? I mean, it's a subsurface here.
So I guess that's my definition of subsurface. I take it to mean take some collection of curves in geodesic representatives of curves in your surface, and then cut along them, and then a subsurface is one of the components.
Then it's convex, right? So that's the total geodesic subspace.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. And also, I include annular subsurfaces as well, and you have to make a special definition for those, which I'm kind of trying to avoid, but they'll creep up on us. But then again, I'll cleverly avoid them.
And in this sum, they are not supposed to be disjoint, right? When you take the sum, like two surfaces could intersect, two subsurfaces.
Right, so the fourth condition said that if the coefficients on each of the terms is positive, then the subsurfaces have to be disjoint. Yeah. Okay, so, right, where am I? Right, I was talking about the structure that we're going to put on the right angle Artin groups and how I don't want to do it. Okay, so what's going to happen is I'm going to make this nice assumption going forward in the talk. Anytime that I say a right angle Artin group, you're going to assume it's a free group. Pretty nice. Okay, so what does this mean for us? It means that no matter what HHS structure we put on the right angle Artin group, the HHS boundary, what's that? Point is, we won't care. This is going to be exactly the same, I guess, homeomorphic to the Gromov boundary of the right angled Artin group. So when I'm making this free assumption, now the Cayley graph of the rag is a tree, so it's Gromov hyperbolic. Okay, so this is nice. Don't worry about HHS structures for rags. Just think about Gromov boundary. Okay, so, right, now I want to tell you a little bit about why my theorem is true. So let's get to the example. So I'm going to use a free group. So gamma is going to be this graph. And then the right angle Artin group will be this ring two free group. And what's my surface? So I'm describing for you now a specific Klein-Enger-Magenhaus embedding that we'll consider. So I'll take, let's see, this here to be XB, and then this side is going to be XA. And then I'll build an embedding as follows. Oh, this is S, by the way. So I'll send A to FA and B to FB. So what are these guys? This is some pseudo-Anosov mapping class group element on XA. And this guy is pseudo-Anosov on XB. Okay, but I'm actually going to be a little bit more picky about what FB is so that we get interesting answer to the question. So I'm going to make an assumption so that this map phi won't extend. And what that assumption is that if I look at this boundary curve here of XB, I'll call it gamma, I want FB to twist curves around gamma. So this condition really isn't that restrictive. If you hand me any mapping class group that's pseudo-Anosov on XB, I'll just compose it with some number of Dane twists in gamma, and then it'll have this property. So you should be careful here. Should twist around, twist curves around gamma. Okay. And okay, passed a sufficiently high powers, blah, blah, blah. Clay Leininger and Magenhaus will tell you that this is a QI embedding. So now I'm going to tell you why it doesn't extend to a boundary map, or at least give you the flavor for it. So to start, I'm going to tell you two sequences that converge to the same point in the Gromov boundary of the right-angled Artin group. So right now I'm drawing a piece of the Cayley graph for the rag. So what are my two sequences? Here's one of them. So A to the N. The other one is going to be A to the N, B to the N. Okay, so turns out that the limit as N goes to infinity of A to the N, these limits are the same. Okay, so if I want this map to not extend then, what I need to show is that when I look at the images of these sequences in the mapping class group, I don't want them to converge to the same point. Okay, so how will we show it? Okay, well, the key observation is the following. So I'm going to take some curve. Where's a different color? It just needs to intersect gamma. So I'll just take this curve here, eta. The key is that phi a n of eta, it doesn't twist around gamma. Or at least it only does so like boundedly many times. Can you see why this would be true? So xa is just over here and it's mixing up the surface, but I'm not twisting around gamma, right? The support of that is disjoint from gamma, and gamma isn't a boundary curve of xa, and so it doesn't twist around gamma. On the other hand, if I look at phi a n b n of eta, this twists approximately n times around gamma. So can you see what's going on here? First, you do b n times. And so you do b n times. And remember, I took f a to do some twisting around gamma. So I pick up about n times of twisting around gamma. And then I do a. And I have to do it a lot of times, I have to do it n times, but the point is that that support's over here, and it's not going to really undo that twisting that I built up from doing b so many times, okay? So it twists approximately n times around gamma. So What this means is that the following set, okay, is a bounded set. Well, I get that from this first condition. So if I look at the projection to the curve graph, the annular curve graph associated to gamma of nu or eta, I always get those two confused. Eta, okay, as take over all n, this is bounded. That's what the first one tells me. Then the second tells me that the projection to the curve graph associated to gamma of phi a n b n, this actually converges to a point which I'll call lambda gamma in the Gromov boundary of the curve graph associated to gamma. Okay, so if you are unfamiliar with the curve graph, an annular curve graph, you can think of it like this. It's just quasi-isometric to z. So it's actually pretty simple to work with. What this is a subsurface projection map. And basically what it's doing, if you take this identification of curve graph of gamma is the same as z, this map projects, this projection is just sending you to the number of times that you twist around the core curve, which is gamma. So under this identification, this number basically is just, there's no twisting, so it's basically like zero, gets sent to zero. And then this guy is basically, you're looking at the sequence n. And as n goes to infinity in z, you know, that converges to a point in the Gromov boundary. So that's what's going on there. Okay, so now, remember we were trying to show that these two limits weren't equal to each other. So, right, so this one, the limit as n goes to infinity of this sequence, we've just convinced ourselves, since that projects to a bounded set, that the coefficient in front of the term corresponding to lambda gamma is going to be a zero, and you know maybe have some other terms, but I won't worry about those. And then this guy will have a term corresponding to lambda gamma, and there'll be some coefficient sitting out front here. Okay, but here's maybe what I'll tell you how to figure out what this coefficient is. Well, I guess what I should say is we want to show it's not zero, right? We're trying to show that these two things aren't equal. So I want to show that C is not equal to zero. So what I have to do is the following. Let's see, I'll go around here. I have to check that, right. So I need to show for all subsurfaces W that the distance in the curve graph of gamma, okay, let me write and then I'll talk. So this needs to grow at least as fast as this projection. So project to the curve graph this. So here, this is just some curve in W. So basically what I'm saying is you want to make sure none of the other growths dominate that growth. It wasn't enough that you just went to infinity. You have to check that your growth was fast enough compared to the other ones. So I won't tell you the specifics of how to determine that this growth is at least as fast, but I'll just say the tools involved. So you use Maser and Minsky's bounded geodesic image theorem. You use the Bernstein inequality. And you use some other properties of these subsurface projections. Namely, I use the fact that they're like K Lipschitz. Maybe you can take K to be 4 or something. So anyway, I think that completes the proof once you establish that C is greater than 0. And then you can see that this embedding doesn't extend to a boundary map. So I'll stop there.
Are there any
questions?
Is this, I mean, is there a like a group action on this boundaries?
Yeah, yeah. So the mapping class group acts on its boundary.
Is it a metric space in any sense?
I don't know.
If the group, if this boundary, the HHS boundary, is a metric space?
Yeah. Is there any metric that gives it a pole?
Yeah, I'm not. I mean, in the paper, they prove that it's Hausdorff, but I don't think I don't know that they prove it's metrizable. Durham,
Durham. Yeah.
I'm just trying to figure out, so what's the action there?
For the case of the mapping class group?
For the Artin group, or say two elements that commute.
Okay, so for the action for...
How does the Z2 act on the boundary?
Well, I mean, I guess I first have to tell you, define what the boundary is. So you have to understand what the Gromov hyperbolic spaces associated to Z2 are. But in that case, what the structure is, so here you look at the Cayley graph of Z2 and the two hyperbolic spaces that you consider is this and this. And then how does it act? Well, I guess you take parallelism classes of these lines. That's why I just highlighted one. And so you
so
act by...
In this
sure, so
like,
you...
Z2, like in the mapping class group, a copy of Z2 embedded in subgroup, Z2 subgroup.
Yeah.
How does it act on that boundary, on that complicated thing?
For the boundary of the mapping class group?
Yeah.
Okay, so, right, a point in the boundary looks like this. And so we'll take some mapping class group element F, see how it acts. So you don't change the coefficients at all, but you apply F to the point in the boundary.
Which is sublamination.
Yeah, you can think of it as some ending lamination on the subsurface, but you could also just think of a point as a sequence living in Y. So now this is some sequence in Y. And then the whole thing will be a sequence in Fy, also in its Gromov boundary.
So it's some kind of secret complicated thing that's hard to go with a
degree. Yeah, I don't know. I
think that, you know, she mentioned that the Mazur-Minsky's distance formula kind of illuminates why this is a reasonable thing. I mean, their distance formula tells you that distance in the mapping class group essentially sums of distances and subsurfaces. So going to infinity in a particular way is reflected by going to infinity in subsurfaces. And so this, you know, having the points at infinity somehow being points at infinity of subsurfaces. I mean, that's kind of the intuition maybe behind why this is a, you know, a reasonable object to put in infinity.
Yeah, it would be nice to say something like,
yeah,
in explicit terms. This topological space and the group acts on it this way. Like, so far, it's kind of hidden in the definition.
I mean, I think her description of the action is fairly concrete. Maybe understanding the topology is a little more delicate. But.
Yeah.
Other questions?
I appreciate this description of the topology much better than trying to read it from on this.
Thanks.
Okay, well, before we thank Sarah again, let's meet in the mail room in 30 seconds for lunch.